This is just to confirm now that all the audio streams and video streams for this meeting are live on Facebook and on YouTube.
Do you want me to do something? Okay. Sweetheart. Hi, darling. Lovely to hear you. Listen, I can't really talk at the moment because I'm in a Zoom meeting, which is just about to start.
So thank you to those people on the different platforms for coming. Now, you will see occasionally people's faces popping up in the live stream. We are trying to moderate this meeting, so we are only going to be showing people who are actually participating in the meeting. So if at any point your camera appears, don't worry if it says a host has turned your camera off. That is because this meeting is being moderated. So I thank everyone for coming, first of all, and just a little bit about information about how to contribute to the meeting. And this is different depending on which platform you are watching on. So please take care and listen for the correct one. For the majority of people who are on Zoom, you should be able to see a chat box on the window. If you can't, you'll need to move your mouse around the Zoom panel and press the speech bubble chat, which should have a pop-up at the bottom of the screen here. But if you can see the chat at the bottom of the screen, if you want to say something, you need to just type any random letter into that chat window. Now, I'm going to introduce a few other people who are at the meeting today. And I'm mainly doing this now because I think all of them have now turned their cameras on at various points. So I'd like to introduce Councillor Leslie Mavin, Councillor Eric Mavin, and Councillor Katie Corrigan, who are here. And hopefully one of the admin team will be turning their cameras on shortly. And they'll be able to say hello to you all. So we should have now on the screen Katie Corrigan, Leslie Mavin, and Eric Mavin. We'll get there. Can you unmute them as well, please? We're getting there. Hello. So we should now have our county councillors here, and they should also be able to speak. So hello, Katie, Leslie, and Eric. Brilliant. So additionally, those people who are watching on Facebook and YouTube, if you need to contribute, simply type a comment into the chat windows on both of those platforms, and they will come to my screen on my right, and I will put those into the conversation. So, firstly, I'm just going to give everybody a little update of what's been happening since the last formal GRA meeting, which was way back in February. As you know, because of the pandemic, we cancelled the March meeting, and then we stopped all in-person activities of the Residents Association, which includes our annual general meeting, which was due to take place in April. Those are postponed, they are not cancelled. And what we are doing is, as a committee, we are carrying on in post until such a point that we can safely hold a Residents Association meeting in person, whether that be probably at the latter half of this year or maybe even in the start of next year. But obviously that will be based on government advice regarding safety. As that being said, we are going to try and hold periodic virtual meetings to discuss key issues and things that are going on. The committee and the councillors who are with us today and other members of the community have still been carrying out various activities. We've been meeting in a coordinated way with representatives from people like Laurel Avenue Community Association, City of Durham Parish Council, Belmont Parish Council, and also local churches and volunteer organisations to try and make sure that we could help with whatever COVID-19 response was needed in the area. I'm pleased to say that several of these schemes that have been going on in the background have had very good success, but there is one that is more interest of residents and we could actually do with some support with. We're starting a new project to provide a swap and take wellbeing table with free access to items that can help individuals and families get through this difficult time. These items will be available in the Baptist Church on Sunderland Road on Saturday mornings from Saturday the 27th of June. People going to the food bank, which is also held at the Baptist Church or living locally, will be able to take items which will hopefully support their mental health. These items will include jigsaws, books, DVDs, colouring in sheets, knitting patterns and spare wool, etc. These can then be returned if applicable and swapped for others. All received items and those handled will be quarantined for 1 week before reissue to prevent COVID-19 spreading. Currently asking for good condition donations of the following: saws or books for all ages, DVDs, board games, craft items, i.e. spare wool, fabric, knitting needles, embroidery kits, etc. Volunteers are advising for donations on Saturday the 20th of June so they can be quarantined in time for the first session on Saturday the 27th of June. These donations can be collected from doorsteps at the end of drives to promote social distancing. To donate or for more information, please contact Belmont Parish Councillor Christine Fletcher, who's taking the lead on this, by her email address or telephone number, which will be published in email or on social media soon. And this particular project has been working with local church groups, including the Baptist Church, the Emmanuel Church, local councillors, the Gilesgate Residents Association and the Laurel Avenue Community Association. So that's one of the projects that we're being involved with at the moment. Now, the reason that we've had this meeting has been called is because there are a lot of consultations going on, which require the input of residents. And shortly, I'm going to be giving you a little presentation on one of those, which is modifications to the County Durham plan, as you can see by our agenda. And what we'll do is we'll be progressing through the agenda items in order, and there will be plenty of time for the people who are here to respond to those items. But when the items are being presented, all the microphones are going to be turned off so that you can see the presentation and listen, and then we'll activate everything and let people come in one at a time. So we're going to start off now with item 3, which is consideration of the GRA response, if any, consultations on the modifications of the County Durham plan. So in a couple of seconds, you should be able to see a presentation on your screen. And can you mute the audio and videos on all the participants, please? Okay, so this we contacted the Durham County Council Special Policy Team to get some input to our meeting on these consultations to the County Durham Plan. Unfortunately, they were unable to send a member of the team to this meeting because it was on a weekend. However, Michelle Robinson, who's the planning team leader, was able to send us some slides and background information, and which I'm going to present to you all now. And as I say, following this, I'll try and open the meeting up for discussion on the issues that arise. So the background to the plan is that there are three rounds of public consultation on the plan. One of them was in 2016, there was then preferred options in 2018 and pre-submission in 2019. The plan was then submitted to the Ministry of Housing, Communities and Local Government on the 28th of June 2019 for independent examination. And Inspector William Fieldhouse was appointed to consider the soundness of the County Durham plan. Hearing sessions were held over 4 weeks at the Glebe Centre in Merton between October and December 2019, and an additional hearing was held on the 6th of February. The Council subsequently received the Inspector's post-hearing advice. In it, the Inspector set out a number of main modifications he considered necessary to make the plan sound, including a number that the Council proposed. And during the following sessions, most recent to action the points or questions from the Inspector. So these main modifications were produced, and this is what's being consulted on at the moment. They have been subjected to a sustainability appraisal. They include the removal of the plan for a northern and western relief road around Durham City, the removal of the corridor of interest for a possible future Barnard Castle relief road, the approach to development on unallocated sites has been made much more flexible, older persons housing, which is increasing the portion of accessible and adaptable homes from 10% to 66% on future developments. and amendments to Aikenhead's proposals to remove reference to ancillary uses such as hotels and the reference to the future development of the police playing field and limited car parking existing levels. Those were main issues. And when I was having our discussion with Michelle, I asked her what specific issues were related to the Giles Gate area. And she highlighted three that I want to raise in more detail. Firstly, there are a change in policy to the development of unallocated sites that are no longer applicable to sites just within the built-up areas, and it can also apply to sites which are well related to a settlement. However, 10 criterion still need to be met, and all other relevant policies within the development will still apply, for example, the Green Belt, Historic Environment and Biodiversity. So that was the reference to making it slightly more flexible. It just enables it to be used in a wider area, but does not change the criteria, as far as I can tell. That is, I know it's very small print, that is the text of the proposal for development of unallocated sites. And for those of you who've looked at the agenda in the period prior to the meeting, you'll see that there is a detailed link to these documents available for your viewing. So, with relating specifically to Giles Gate, the plan contains the proposal for housing allocation at Giles Gate School of 60 dwellings. And it should be noted that this is to remain as an allocation in the new plan. However, it is made explicit in the plan that there must be a financial contribution to any developer to re-provide playing fields that are lost because of development. The second area that is subject to development, which is our area of action, is the sustainable urban expansion proposal for Sherburn Road, an allocation of 420 dwellings that is proposed on the maps. The allocation will stay as it is, however, the consultation is to add terms to provide greater protection to views of the World Heritage Site and clarity around the protection for Bent House Farm, Old Durham Beck and Old Durham. And what that's talking about is whenever proposals are submitted for development on these sites, to make sure that there is protection between that development and the existing buildings. So at the moment, the consultation on these changes are being sought over a period of 8 weeks. It is not a repeat of any previously submitted comments which had already been considered, and these need to be submitted by the 21st of July. At the end of the consultation, the Council will forward the consultation comments to the programme officer, along with the report listing all of the representations, a summary of the main issues raised and a brief response, which the inspector will then consider before finalising the County Durham plan. So that is the presentation on the issues that has been given. And I'm now going to invite anybody who has been watching this meeting on whatever means to either place a note in the Zoom chat, the Facebook chat or the YouTube chat. If they want to speak, just type a letter and I will call you to speak. Please, I'm open now this for opinions. Is anybody there? Have I been speaking to nobody? Can you... John Ashby, can you turn John Ashby's microphone and video on, please? Hi, John.
Well, hello, Richard. Hello, everybody. Thanks for unmuting me. This set of main modifications, there's 178 of them, are ways to make the plan sound, and it's really important to get that done. The county and the city have too long been without any kind of strategic planning framework, and developers have been taking advantage of that. I think, certainly from the Durham City Parish Council point of view, we support and welcome a great many of the changes that the inspectors required. It's a pity the County Council needed telling that, because if they'd taken any notice of representations that people made, we wouldn't have had this long delay. Nevertheless, what the inspector's requiring is very welcome, and the parish council will be putting in a number of points where we think further improvements are needed. But to the best of my assessment, none of them desperately affect Gilesgate, except perhaps this. There are policies to do with PBSAs, purpose-built student accommodation, that is, and HMOs, housing in multiple occupation. And the one on PBSAs is absolutely fine in my view. I'll go into that if anybody wants to ask. The one on HMOs, County Council's found itself in a bit of a pickle. The policy currently is that in an area where somebody proposes a new or extended HMO, and there are already more than 10% of HMOs of all properties in the 100-meter radius of that, then that's the threshold. It's anything above 10%, the answer's no. And the County Council's been operating a kind of get-out clause that if the area is already pretty saturated with HMOs, then they won't go on resisting them. They'll allow it to become 100% student HMOs. And that position is one which the Parish Council doesn't agree with and will be continuing to assert that once the 10% threshold's been exceeded, that's it. There shouldn't be more HMOs within the 100 metres of any proposal. That's really the only big thing, Richard and others, that the City of Durham Parish Council would be saying that relates, I think, to Gilesgate, as did other areas of the town. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those that comment, John. I'm just looking through and I'm noticing I can't see anybody else who's making communications. I'm wondering if that's because people are struggling to get my attention using the chat function. So would you be able, Maria, to just activate the video link to everybody, please? I think there is a button to do that. Invite everybody to share video. So if you want to say something, when you're given a link to share video, please just sort of wave at the camera and I should be able to see you. There aren't too many people in this meeting, so fortunately it's going to be a little bit easier. And I'm now starting to see on my screen at least several more people, so that's a good thing.
Hello, Katie.
I think cameras are being activated, so I can only see three of them, but I'm suspecting there are more people as well. Okay, so can I thank then everybody for coming once again, and once I get this screen working, gallery, there we are. Does anybody have any comments now that they would like to make on those proposals, having heard my statement, having heard John? I'm getting Eric Mervyn waving. Turn on your microphone, Eric. You're good to go.
Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you fine.
I've replied to the consultation, and I agree with what the inspector says. I think it's been a long, drawn-out process. It shouldn't have taken this long, and hopefully this will be the end of it. What I have said is that as part of this, I'd like to say the Belmont Viaduct reopen again for cyclists and walkers from Belmont through Cape Yet into Durham. And that's what I said. It's a renovation and repair of the Belmont Viaduct for walkers and cyclists. And that's what I put in the consultation. As for HMOs, the fella said that houses are multiple application. I always say it stands for how many others. Because we do get a lot of HMOs in our parish. And we need to keep a strong, firm eye on the situation.
Thank you for that, Eric. Does anybody else wish to comment on the proposals, the ones relating to Gilesgate or any of the others? Because What we're at the status of now doing is we need to make a decision as to whether the Residents Association as a body wants to put in some a formal reply to this consultation, or whether we should just let individuals who are interested in particular areas respond to those areas on their own, which they can, of course, do anyway, or whether we need a formal response from the Residents Association. So we've got, I'm hoping that Carol has made notes of what John and Eric have said there. So if nobody else has anything they would like to input, and I'm just checking on the Facebook and on the YouTube, and I'm not getting... Eric, go on. Your microphone's not on, Eric. Give a second.
Can you hear?
Yeah.
I think it carries more clout if you do. There's a Childsgate Residents Association group. I'm sure the parish council will be doing the same, having some response. You can do it as Childsgate Residents group, and the members of that can also do it as well.
Indeed. In which case, does anybody have, apart from what John has raised, I'm seeing Adrienne waving, I'll finish my sentence and then let her come in. Does anybody have any response to specific areas other than those that have been raised or the ones that were mentioned in the presentation? So Adrienne was waving. Can we put Adrienne's microphone on? Oh, Adrienne, can you put your... There we go. Please.
Just a quick query about the 420 houses at Sherburn. Just wondering, have the traffic implications for Sunderland Road and Sherburn Road been considered?
Right. One thing that we need to remember is that this is not a planning application. This isn't we're going to build this house here. This is saying that this land is allocated to that purpose, and that if a developer was to come and say, I want to build 120 houses on that site, the council would look favourably on it. That's what a planning framework is. And I'm sure that either the councillors or John or somebody who knows a little bit more about planning will either support me or wave at me and tell me I'm wrong. But this is effectively a guidance document that was being proposed. It's not saying that there's going to be, 30 houses there, a roundabout, a junction or whatever. It's effectively a guideline, set of guidelines. Mm-hmm. So has traffic been considered? The answer to that is probably no, in the sense that the specific traffic needs for a specific development to be proposed haven't been considered. They've just said that this area is suitable for that kind of future development. Does that make sense, Adrienne? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Also, as was mentioned in the presentation, this is a consultation on the changes to make it valid. It's not a consultation on the substantive. They've in the inquiry in public, they looked at the proposal to put the houses on Sherburn Road and said that that proposal is reasonable. Mm-hmm. What they've said is that it's not reasonable to have it butting right up to the existing buildings, and that there should be some measures taken to separate the developments out. That's the change, and also to make sure that the views of the cathedral and the World Heritage Site are protected, which is an addition to that development. So it's just the changes that are being consulted on, not the proposal in total. Does that make sense?
It's fine.
I'm seeing that John Ashby is nodding at that, so that's your interpretation of this as well, isn't it, John? Yes, good. Right, does anybody have any other input that they would like to say regarding those proposed changes? I'm looking on the chat. Chris Fletcher is here, but her internet is struggling. So that's fine. As I've said, does any more comments on this? Otherwise, I think what we need to do, Carol, is summarise those concerns about HMOs, summarise the topic about Belmont Viaduct, and as say these are the things that have been brought up at our meeting, and respond with those to the consultation. Yes, Carol, you can speak. Just turn your microphone on.
I just have a query, Eric, about the Belmont Viaduct. I support this as well, but can we make a comment on it under this particular consultation? Because it's not mentioned in the plan. It was mentioned if they were going to build a relief road over it. So can you just put me right there? I mean, I'd have thought the street space might be a better consultation to mention it.
Eric, I think your microphone is being turned on or is turned on, so please just respond directly.
Yeah. Hello, Carol. Carol, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Right. Yes. I've mentioned in the consultation because we've been talking about this in private to reopen the cycle and pathway. It'll be a renovation and reopening of the Belmont Viaduct for walkers and cyclists to add the reopen route, the cycle route into Durham through Cabia. We're trying to fund it by 106 money. That's what I put in the consultation.
Right, okay.
It was meant to happen a few years ago, and we actually got the money for it, and the council spent the money on something else. So now I've contacted the county council along with other councillors and said, at this time, when more people are cycling and walking, it would be good for the environment, good for everybody, it ticks all the right boxes to open this cycle route.
Right. Okay. Thank you. So we can comment. I understand that.
Okay, does anybody have any other input from this topic, or are we safe to move on to the next agenda item, which is the consideration of response to the consultation on street space? So any input on that anymore? Say now. I'm looking at the 8 people who are watching on Facebook, the 2 people watching on YouTube, and the 15 people who are in this chat. If you do want to comment, put something in the comments now on any of those platforms. I'm not seeing any comments, but I am seeing Roger writing something. So, Roger, do you want to say something? If you do, just give me a thumbs up. Or if you don't want to say anything, can you activate Roger, please?
Okay.
Roger, your microphone's on.
Can you hear me now? Yes. I wasn't trying to write something. I was just fiddling with the screen. But as you've asked me to speak, my question is about the relief road was there partly to ease traffic in and would have had an effect in our area. If it's not going to happen, do we have the opportunity to say something about what are they going to do instead, or what would they propose to do instead, or do we have a proposal in relation to traffic management in the Giles Gate area? Because presumably there was a problem that relief road was intended to solve. The problem is still there. The relief road's gone. Do we still have a problem that we could say something about?
Does anybody want to respond to that in any way? Eric? And I've got John waiting as well. So if Eric wants to speak first, and then I'll take John Ashby.
Of course you can. If you go on the consultation, you can just air any of your concerns regarding this. I mean, there's going to be an impact, obviously, with traffic, because, I mean, traffic's already a nightmare, especially going into Durham, down Giles Gate Bank. So, yes, just put anything you want on the consultation, any concerns you have.
John Ashby?
Thanks, Richard. The reasons why the Northern Bypass comprehensively got thrown out by the inspector are to do with the fact that it had very little contribution to the traffic problems in the town. The building of the Northern Relief Road took 13% of the traffic out of the town. And it's not difficult to do the maths. That leaves 87% still coming through the town. And the inspector thought, it was a hell of a lot of money for nothing. And of course, it also damaged green areas and nature. So it was a doomed project, frankly. The traffic problems of the town are partly because of its medieval street pattern, but they're in many ways common to the whole country. Over-dependence on motor traffic. There is a very good Durham City sustainable traffic plan and set of actions which the County Council must be commended for, and all efforts should be put to implementing those proposals, not just tarmacking more green spaces. Taking Eric's point about you can say what you like, this inspector was extraordinarily rigorous and penetrating, and he has intervened on individual words in policies that he felt just didn't cut the mustard. So it is very important that if people think there's something missing or something that should be said differently, put it to the County Council. They're not going to be the judges of it. They have to simply send it in to the inspector with their commentary, and it'll be up to Mr. Fieldhouse whether he sees merit in what's being said. So do say what you want. Thank you.
Okay, John, thank you very much for that. And I think one of the things that's worth remembering is that, as it said in the presentation, everybody is welcome to contribute to this consultation individually. You don't have to just rely on the Residents Association or whatever to respond. The consultation documents are available online. The details are there, durham.gov.uk/CDP, via the online consultation portal. You can write to Free Post Spatial Policy, just that on the envelope, or email the address on the screen. You can also get further advice or paper copies via that telephone number there. What I'm going to propose now is that we head over to item 4 on the agenda, the consideration of the consultation on street space. Carol has been working on this one, so I'm going to hand it over to her now to introduce this. Carol, over to you.
Right, well, I'm looking at this on my screen now, so I can't see you, but I will try and just tell you a little bit about it and then come back. The purpose of this consultation is to improve space for people to ensure it is easy to social distance. And they've handed over the what they're calling it as a project to this very, very good organisation called Commonplace, and they are, for on behalf of Durham County Council, are exploring opportunities to make the space for people on foot and on bikes or using wheelchairs or pushchairs, make it easier for them, allow them to keep social distancing, but make essential journeys and also take exercise during the lockdown and through recovery. And then that what they're saying is that as people do start returning to work and school, we need to look at solutions that help people carry on with their lives safely. What they're also saying is that these are to be considered temporary emergency changes. So for people travelling on foot or bike or whatever at the moment. And the government has made funding available for this as part of its emergency response. Some of these opportunities, just to give you some examples, are things like creating pop-up cycle lanes or reducing traffic on certain roads, introducing 20 mile an hour speed limits, extra cycle parking, etc., etc. And encouraging people generally to walk and cycle more and drive less. Now, what you then do is a really quite interesting sort of consultation. You go on the site, which is we've got on our agenda. You go into menu, you look at about the project, you scale down to the bottom, and then at the bottom of that, it's got a map with lots of things sticking in into it, and you can look at existing comments that have been made, and you can also put your postcode in and make your own comments. There've only been a couple. There's one been made up at Tesco's and Aldi at the moment, and there's been a couple on Sunderland Road, which is mostly about making them more cycle friendly. But it's good. The consultation lasts till the 31st of July, and I think that there's every possibility of making use of the funding that's available for some improvements that could be longer lasting than they're suggesting. And now I don't know whether I'm gone.
Okay, Carol, don't worry.
Yeah.
Don't panic about what's going on in your computer screen.
I'm here now. I'm here. And I'm just saying, would Eric, Leslie, Katie, anybody like to say anything more about it? And any ideas that anybody else has got that we might put forward?
Okay, so that is now open to the floor. Is anybody waving at me? Eric, go for it. Just wait a second while you get your microphone. There you go.
All right. Yes, I've had a look at this, Carol, and it is temporary. And what I was thinking of, asking if the unparished areas could make a 20-mile-per-hour zone, even if it's just 20, because all the other parishes 20 miles per hour. But I think this is too little too late, because this social distancing, my experience, I mean, I've been isolated now for nearly 13 weeks, and a lot of people just don't adhere to social distancing, which is really annoying on my part. So although I agree with the project, I don't think it's, I don't know, viable or workable. That's my opinion.
Anybody else like to input, Leslie? Can you give Leslie a microphone, please?
Yep. Yeah, and I just say that I do think this managing a lot of the things you mentioned, the pop-up cycle lanes, and I think this is a good time to start doing things like that, but to look to keep them for the future, because I think it's something really, really needed. Definitely cycle lanes, and I'd be all for that. Social distancing, I don't know, I hear a lot of talk about them possibly reducing the 2 metres down to 1 metre, 1.5 metres. And I'm thinking, if 2 metres was the scientific advice, why are we then reducing it? But yeah, I'd certainly support parts of it.
Okay, I saw Carol had your hand back up. Remember, you're in this section, this is your section, so you could just talk, Carol.
Okay. Like you, Leslie, I'm concerned about, and Eric, that it's temporary. And I was wondering if there was something we could do that would be temporary, but that would make things a little bit better at the moment. For example, you all know I'm on my hobby horse here, but if we asked them to clear the paths in Sherburn Road Nature Reserve so that people could get more easily down to the river and back, that would only be temporary because the brambles, etc., would grow again, but it would be a benefit. And there may be some other things like that. That's all I'm thinking.
I'm just going to interject here because we've got a couple of comments coming through on the Facebook. And Facebook does have a bit of about a 20-second delay compared to the live meeting. So it's important that we make sure that we get everybody in. It's from Chris Fletcher. She wasn't aware of the consultation and will look into the info. She agrees with Eric regarding social distancing and also thinks that they are about to reduce it and says that that will have a massive impact. And she also agrees with what Leslie has been saying about the scientific advice. So we're getting comments. That I'm just basically reading out anything that comes in on the other platforms. So that's from Chris Fletcher. Okay. Sylvia, are you wanting to say something here? Yes, can you give Sylvia a microphone, please? And then we'll go for Eric. Sylvia, have you got a microphone? Hi, Sylvia. You should be getting a message on your screen asking you to unmute your microphone.
Okay.
Yeah, there we go. I can hear you.
Yep. I would like to support Carol's remarks she's just made. I was actually thinking about that area, and any temporary area will not attract people if it's terribly neglected. The area behind where Carol lives, I think, is potentially wonderful. And also any temporary arrangement also has the potential to be permanent, so it's a good starting place, and also it's going to highlight litter problems and neglected areas, which is great. If they're highlighted, people then want to use them, don't like using them, might be prepared to tidy them up, and then the best that can happen is that some of them are permanent. So I agree exactly with Carol.
Okay, I'm going to go over to Eric because he had his hand up a minute ago, and then I've got Adrienne. So can you put Eric on and then queue up Adrienne, please?
Yeah, Carol, I totally agree with that. I mean, you could get the vegetation and everything cut back and maybe ask for some fencing to be put up. It might be temporary, but once you get it up, it might remain there.
Well, we're getting a bench there as well on the field, so, you know, it's all part of,
I'd aim for fencing as well.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and can we have Adrienne, please?
Just to say, like Carol, I have a special interest in this area because it's been behind my house too. And during the lockdown, we've seen a lot more families using it, bringing little children to the castle. I mean, we have had some problems there with people, you know, standing around drinking and taking drugs in that area. And but a lot more people have brought their children through. And it's a shame because it's never going to grow like anything. They won't be able to go around the equipment. It's going to look a mess again. So I completely agree. We also, once again, have a problem with people bombing around on motorbikes there, which we've reported again and again and again to the police. And we're promised a call from a beat officer. Nothing ever happens, but we're still reporting it every time it happens. So it's a really usable area that's sort of being used more now. People are more aware of it, but it's still got a little blight on it in different respects. So it would be a good area to develop more.
Okay. Thank you very much, Adrienne. Does anybody else have any comments before I read out what Chris has written on Facebook? Okay. Good points made by Carol. Environmental improvements may be temporary initially, but will show what can be done. Perhaps improvements can be done in partnership and seeks to develop sustainable approaches. So essentially, I think the feedback I'm getting is that those environmental issues that Carol and Sylvia and Adrienne have talked about are definitely ones that we should include in our feedback. And I think if anybody else in the meeting or outside of the meeting watching it later on wants to comment on that, you can find the link to the consultation on the agenda. And I think what you're saying, Carol, is that anybody can and should contribute at this point.
Definitely, yes.
Yeah. OK, Eric. Microphone to Eric. Yeah, good.
Can I just say it, Adrienne? I'll report the off-road bikes to their place for it.
OK. Adrienne's giving me a thumbs up, so she's heard that. Brilliant. Okay, now we do need to move on with our agenda because we still have quite a large number to discuss. And we are now into item 5, which is consultation planning issues in the non-parished area. And I believe some people said that they needed to leave at this point. So if you do need to leave, just close down your chat and it will you should be able to join back in a few minutes. Okay, so if anybody who needs to leave for this at this point has left, we will carry on. So we have a few items that are being discussed, and what I propose doing is just going through them one at a time. And if anybody has anything that they would like to comment on or add, then please do so at the relevant points. And I'll just read them out and then we'll go from there. So the first proposal, which is A, is on 64 Giles Gate and is a proposal for change of use from a dwelling house to a house in multiple occupation. Now, in previous parts of the previous meetings of the Residents Association, we've agreed that if HMO changes are only going to be in name, they're not going to make any fundamental changes to the property. For instance, they're going to a proposal that keeps the same number of bedrooms, so the same number of people in the house, and is essentially just putting locks on doors. We are not going to place a comment on because we think it's more important to focus our attention on those HMOs that are making fundamental changes to places in our community. So, and Laura, on Facebook, I'm going to take that as any other business item. So don't worry about that. I'll pick that up later. So this one, this application for 64 Giles Gate is a proposal that does not fundamentally change the nature of the property. It is going from, I believe, a three-bedroom house to a three-bedroom HMO. And with that proposal, that kind of plan that we have, I don't think that there should be any objection from the City of Durham Parish Council, from the Giles Gate Residents Association to this. It should be noted, of course, that the City of Durham Parish Council has objected to this, as this is in the area that crosses over between the Parish Council and the Residents Association. Now, at the does anybody have any comments then on item A? That's apologies from Claire, who's leaving the meeting now. And if there's any, I didn't see the end of that. If there's anything that she could do or help with, contact her on the details that are on the screen. So thank you very much, Claire. So with regard to that one, if anybody has any input on item A, please wave at me. Otherwise, we will move swiftly on, because item B, I think, needs more talking about, which is a change of use from a dwelling house to a small house in multiple occupation. This is essentially the conversion of a garage with a granny flat into a self-contained three-bedroom HMO. Now, this is the sort of thing I was talking about, because this is going to increase the number of people in the area. It creates a reduction in parking in the area. This is on Station Lane, which is also, I believe, in the Parish Council area. But I didn't, when I checked this up, there wasn't a comment from the Parish Council on this. So I don't know if John wants to make sure that they've seen that application. It's actually directly behind the house for the previous one. But with our policy is to make a comment if there is a substantial change. I think this constitutes a substantial change. So if the meeting is happy, I think we should make a comment regarding that in the consultation that's currently taking place. Does anybody have any opinions? I'm seeing people nodding. If anyone wants to actually speak up here, who's that waving at me? Dawn, can you put Dawn's microphone on?
Yeah, I just think there's a danger that all these multiple occupancy requests are just going to take over Giles Gate as well as the rest of Durham with students. And I think we've got our fair share of student apartments and housing up here. And I think we would be right to oppose it.
Okay, does anybody else have anything they would like to add about that? I'm giving it a couple of seconds for Facebook and YouTube. No, I'm not getting anything. So I think that comment needs to be submitted to the council. So please, can you make a note of that, Carol, for the minutes? Item C is regarding the another change of use at 42 The Sidings. This one is a two-bedroom property being proposed to change into a two-bedroom house in multiple occupation, which seems like a very, very small property. And as we've said before, with our principles of, you know, if there's no fundamental changes, we're not going to respond. This is another one where it's, I suspect it's currently let and they want to let it to more than one person. But that's the 42 The Sidings. I'm not seeing anybody waving frantically at me about that one. So I'm going to move on to the slightly larger and possibly more controversial, I don't know, issues regarding Hudson House, which is the former Lord Gort or Last Orders pub, depending on when you moved into Durham, in Galt Place. And this is now the currently as the offices for Durham Action on Social Housing, or DASH. And there is a proposal that this be part of this building be converted into four affordable apartments, with the target residents being local people. DASH are moving more into the social housing sector because they've set up a company called Keep Your Homes, which is essentially similar to Believe Housing and the other housing associations in the area. And this is basically to convert some of the unused space or less used space in the HQ building to provide four apartments. This is separate to the proposal straight after it, so we will treat them separately. So does anybody have any comments on the addition of apartments to Hudson House? I'm seeing nobody waving, I'm seeing no sound, and I'm hearing no sound. So I'm assuming that that is that nobody has any particular opinions either way. Okay, I'm also going to now carry on to item E, which is sort of linked to it because it is by the same organisation, Keep Your Homes. And there is a redundant area of space around the back of Hudson House, which used to be the site of some garages that were pulled down, and it's now just an open, rubbly tarmac space. And the proposal is to put a set of 4 two-storey terrace houses, again, affordable and being done by Keep Your Homes, the housing association, with, again, the target residents of these being local people. Again, we're minded not to respond to this application. And the reason I said that is because it is targeting local residents. And I think there is a need for affordable accommodation in this area. And I have had some feedback from a couple of people supporting this application. Eric has got his hand up, so I will go over to Eric and shut up. Can you put Eric on, please?
Yeah, hello there. I've responded to this application and I haven't got any objections. All I did say was I want them to adhere to the recommendations of the tree survey and then implement that and make sure the trees are protected during construction. And that's all I've said on this. It is affordable housing and it's needed in the area.
Okay, anybody else? I think, Carol, did you have somebody who had contacted you about that one?
No, I was just going to read out the fact that Belmont are actually quite supportive of this. I have a general query. You say that for the other planning issues, we're not going to respond at all. Should we not sometimes respond supporting proposals where they make a positive difference to the locality, and maybe this Gort place is one of those? So rather than just not responding at all, we say or send in a comment saying jolly good idea, making provision for local residents. That's all.
I'm more than happy to do that, but that obviously requires the decision of the majority. It's not something that I can say. What I'm just saying is that there is, as far as I'm concerned, there are no issues. Do people here think that we should have a positive response to that? If so, let's send a positive response in. So I'm looking at the residents here. If you think we should have a positive response, can you just give me a thumbs up? Well, I think that's pretty unanimous. So I will make sure a positive response is put into that. John Ashby's got his hand up. So, John, do you want to say something?
Thanks, Richard. I think that point about being positive where we can be is very important, and I'm glad that there's support for doing that. But this whole issue of what kind of houses and the effect on community balance takes me back to the question of HMOs. And it isn't just that there isn't a physical change to the property outside, or even the number of bedrooms isn't changing. What does change inevitably is that the student occupants disappear for 5 months of the year. And the problem with having more and more HMOs, even assuming students behave impeccably, is that it undermines retail and other support services in a community. They tend not to have children, so you tend to find that schools begin to not have the number of pupils they need. And that is why the policy, which seems harsh, but is right, the policy about HMOs above 10% not being acceptable, isn't just about the look or the quantum, it's about the effect on balanced and sustainable communities. Thanks.
Dawn is giving me a thumbs up. I think that was saying that she was agreeing with what John said. And I'm also going to agree with what John said. I agree that there is this issue and there is this limit of 10%. And obviously, I'm assuming that limit is the first thing that is taken into consideration when a planning application is submitted. Why GRA took the stance that it did when we discussed this 6 months ago was that we felt that if houses were being fundamentally altered, that means that they could never re-enter the pool for local residents. Whereas if a house is becoming a HMO, that doesn't necessarily mean that it will attract student residents and that it could end up back in the pool again. And if there aren't any fundamental changes to the property, then we were more inclined to support it because it could still be re-adopted. For instance, this house I'm in now, I own it, and it used to be a student house. All the rooms have got Yale locks on the doors, or they haven't, or I took most of them off. And it's back into the circulation as residence. But had this house had, you know, a bedroom put in the loft, been refitted, so it was essentially, you know, a six-bed student house, I wouldn't have moved back into it because it wouldn't be fit for a normal resident. So that's the side of, that's the view that we took 6 months ago when we decided to not object, but not support either, ones that make fundamental changes. And I definitely think that, for instance, that garage proposal, that is sufficiently substantial, a change of nature, that we definitely should object to it without even questioning it. So I hope that made sense. And I mean, I think we can revisit this discussion, but I suspect that this online forum, which by its nature does mean certain people can't access it, probably isn't the forum to deal with a fundamental policy that we're changing. And perhaps when we get back to meeting in person, we might have a longer decision about our discussion about our approach to that. I'm seeing a lot of people sort of nodding at that. So I think that's where we're at. And the final one on the consultation is another, I've just lost the tab, it's another HMO, it's on Musgrave Gardens. I've just lost my copy of the agenda off the screen, but I can remember the rest of it. On Musgrave Gardens, it's a plot that up until about 3 weeks ago when it was sold, was an overgrown mess. The garden, literally, you couldn't walk through it. It was a corner plot on Musgrave Gardens. It's on my dog walking route. The first thing I noticed when I went past this, I've tidied up that garden. And it's the reason is because I suspect it's going to be converted into a HMO. But the one thing that I did spot is that the garden is now tidy and neat and looks a heck of a lot better than it did when it was abandoned. So it may be that the landlord here is actually planning on taking good care of the property, which is fantastic, and we would certainly encourage. But again, it is a three-bedroom house and it's being converted into a three-bedroom HMO. So by our previous policy, we would not object to that on those grounds. We're also probably not going to support it either. Does anybody have any further comments they'd like to make on the planning applications section, or can we move on to the more general community issues discussion? If anybody wants to comment on planning issues, please either wave at me, message in the comments, or I'll give it 20 seconds for people on Facebook and on YouTube to say anything that they want. And if not, we will now move into the more general community issues part of the discussion. So I'm just reactivating the waiting room there, so anybody who popped out can come back in. And so does anybody have any issues regarding the community in general that they want to raise? I mean, I mentioned Chris Fletcher's and our comment regarding the mental health stroke craft table at the Baptist Church on Saturdays, but does anybody have anything that they would like to add that could include councillors' reports or anything like that? Nothing was submitted in advance for this ARB this section, so I'm just going to open it up to the floor. Dawn, do you want to start? Can we give Dawn a microphone?
It's been mentioned already, but this thing with the scooters, they nearly knocked down two people with a pram, an old couple, not to mention myself, going down to Durham Gardens. And then they take over the whole of the green behind Laurel Avenue Primary School, and they just zoom up and down. Well, that's the link for walkers between the fields and the woods and Durham Gardens and all the rest of it. And I just don't see that it's stopped, but it's dangerous. They don't have helmets. They have two or three on a bike. And it's terrible. And I can't let the dog off her lead. And I can't walk there because I'm terrified.
I think this is a very important issue. I'm going to take Adrienne, and then I'm going to take Eric, and then I'm going to comment myself on it. Adrienne.
It's often the same kids and the same bikes, but we have seen sometimes dads out with lads, and you're right, Dawn, no helmets. So obviously there's a risk to the young people riding, but the risk to pedestrians is huge. I mean, they've come at me through the woods before, and I mean, this has been going on for a long time. And, you know, sometimes it sounds like Le Mans out there. That, you know, there's such a racket, and of course it's just behind the police station as well. Yes. But we've never managed to get any traction whatsoever. We're just told to keep a diary of when they do it. Well, it's very random, and usually, of course, by the time we've reported it, they've all roared off. You know, they just get everywhere. They also do donuts on the playing field, which gets very muddy and make a complete mess of that, which I know it's supposed to be kept ready for sport. They go down Rabbit Hill as well. They just make a real mess. Sometimes four-wheeled vehicles as well, not just bikes.
Eric, you're next, and I'll take Carol. Eric? Sorry, you've got the microphone now. I think Maria lost you for a second there.
Like I said before, I will report this, but I think what you need to remember is the police need information, because, like you said, the bikes, they're not there at certain times, so the police, they haven't got their manpower to be there all the time. So they need people to give them information about who's riding the bikes and where do they live. I mean, if you're not happy telling the police that, you can give me the information and I'll pass it on. But I mean, it's not just down there as well. We've got where I live, Grange Road, there's an off-road bike that I've reported two or three times. We've had quad bikes on the playing fields of the community centre as well. But it is very annoying, but I will definitely report to the police.
Carol, do you want to come in there?
Yeah, I think I've just been unmuted. If I could just reply to you. The problem is, Eric, we really have no clue who they are. We don't know. Obviously, they've got no number plates. I mean, I've taken some pictures of a couple of very young lads out with a motorbike, but it was in the distance. You know, it's in there and they're fast, you know, they're gone. So it's really quite difficult. And we've tried to give descriptions of the bikes, but they're just, you know, rubbish old crosses with, you know, no identification whatsoever. It's really difficult. And I appreciate the police's problem with it. But we really do fear that somebody's going to get knocked over because they're just kids. They're lashing about. It's very dangerous.
Eric, your microphone's still on. So if you want to respond, then I'll take Carol.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. It's just very dangerous. And the police, they can't get involved in a high-speed chase with their off-road bike either.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So the police have got a very difficult job actually doing this. But when they do actually catch them, which they have done in the past, they've got the powers to have the bikes scrapped.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Carol? There you go.
Thank you. I just wanted to echo everything that's said, because obviously we're as affected as you all, but also to say that they're travelling quite long distances now. That I was walking at Winnie Hill, you know, not Winnie, yes, the Maiden Castle area, and two of these scooters arrived. Each had two blokes on, which wasn't very good. They must have come across the bridge. They've come quite a long way. And I did manage to get two or three photographs of them, which if you blew them up, you could see and identify if you knew the people. And I sent them to the police, but I've heard nothing. So I really don't know what else we can do except keep going.
One thing that I'm just going to... say is that Chris has just popped into the Facebook chat and said that she's reported also a scooter with four youths on it driving along Sherburn Road, tried to get the registration number and took a photo on her phone, and she's also completely supportive of the concerns that everyone's expressed. And I'm going to say what I was going to contribute a few minutes ago. And that do we think that it's worth, given that this issue has affected now four people that I've in this meeting, and there's four out of 14 people who've had problems with this issue, that it might be worth the Residents Association writing to the police on a kind of formal level and saying that this is a substantial issue. Can you do something with it? And are there any strategies that we can use to help you, help support you dealing with this? So I'm wondering if a letter, as well as what Eric's doing, a letter from the Residents Association might be a positive thing. I've got Dawn's hand up, I've got Eric's hand up, and then I'll take those in that order, please. Dawn?
Yeah, I mean, they're there every afternoon when it's not pouring with rain at about, well, from 3 o'clock onwards. 3 till 6, that sort of time period, if that helps.
So can you just make a little note of that, please? Eric, you're next. When you get your microphone, go for it.
I was busy writing as well. Richard, the more people get in contact with the police about these things, the more clout they've got. So I would definitely get in touch with them by email to the police.
Yeah,
and I'll pass that information on about every afternoon in between 3 and 6. And I find it's a little bit embarrassing that this is going on right next to the police station. I mean, if they can't hear the bikes themselves in the police station.
Yeah, I've recorded that as an action on me to contact the police about this as soon as possible. Does anybody have any other issues they'd like to bring up? Because this idea is a general discussion, so anybody can input on anything that's been affecting them recently. So, Adrienne, microphone. Wait for your microphone. There we go.
Just to say that the area where the proposed car wash was, next to the shops in Sherburn Road, seems to have become a horrible dumping ground now for all kinds of rubbish, and just wondered if there's anything can be done about that.
Eric's got his hand up.
I've reported this to the neighbourhood wardens because there's a lot of chickens hanging about there,
yes.
And it was getting dumped on. And when the neighbourhood wardens come back, which hopefully might be next week or the week after, I'll email them again and ask them to look into this matter. But just before this virus started, they were dealing with the situation.
And Katie has her hand up. Can you put Katie's microphone on, please? Okay,
yeah,
Katie?
Yes, thank you. I've also reported the issue as well. So I think hopefully they're going to do a clean up of the area because it's private land, but there's a problem with chickens. I think they were on the road the other day as well. So it's become quite a big concern. So it's been reported. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else with any items that they would like to raise in this section? Yes, there was a person on Facebook. Thank you, Maria. This person, I'm not entirely sure what the background to this is, but this is possibly because of our links to the wider Durham community and the fact that there's also the Durham history groups and things that are associated are linked to the GRA account. But somebody has asked, can anybody help with information regarding Mabel Bales Parker or Cummings, who lived in Anand Road? I think this might be a family history request or something, but I'm just mentioning it because someone put it in the Facebook chat. I suspect if you if you do want to get involved in that, just pop into the Facebook chat and speak to the person themselves. So that was just a, I think probably a family history request that somebody had popped in. Okay, does anybody have any other business that they would like to raise before I close this meeting? Sorry, Katie, go for it.
Sorry, I think Claire wanted to say a couple of things, but unfortunately she had to leave. So I think just, can I do an update from Claire, if that's all right?
Yes, of course.
Yeah. So she's just talked about Laurel Avenue's response to COVID, and they've been doing weekly youth packs, have been delivered each Monday, fortnightly food parcels have been delivered to the most vulnerable families in the community. This is on a referral basis. Virtual coffee mornings are being held twice a week, and support's given via email and telephone. And also that she has iPads and Wi-Fi devices on loan to families, so that children can complete schoolwork and communicate. And they're looking forward to working on a Gilesgate partnership project. And she just wanted me to mention that here.
Brilliant, Katie. Thank you very much for that. And I've also got Leslie with a hand up, so I'll take that. Go for it.
Am I open? Yeah. So could you just email all that to us, Katie? Because what I'd like to do is compile a kind of shout out for COVID and across the board, Belmont, Gilesgate, Moor, just a pamphlet to go out to everybody of all the good things people have done and asking for people to send in of other people. So that's something that could be included in that, and that would be great.
Katie is nodding and smiling but hasn't got a microphone on.
Yeah, I'll do that.
And if you know of anyone else, and if anyone in the residence does that deserves, you know, a paragraph as a shout out for good stuff.
Quite a lot of food bank stuff going on as well. So
that'd be great.
Chris is who's watching in the Facebook here. Says that she missed the extra comments regarding the wellbeing table, which she's been organising. And I think it's worth actually popping a shout out to her as well, because she's been picking, based on the previous discussion we've had, she's been picking quite a lot of extra loaves of bread and baked goods and things from various supermarkets in the area and delivering them to people in need for the last, I'm not sure, 4, 5, 6 weeks maybe. And I think she deserves a thank you for doing that. Regarding Chris, because I know you can see this and hear me, regarding the wellbeing table, nobody mentioned anything positive or negative about it. It was mentioned, and I let people know that how to contribute. If anybody does have any comments about that wellbeing table that I mentioned at the start, Sylvia's got a hand up. Do you want to come in on that? Sylvia, microphone, please. Sorry, don't. Go for it.
Okay. Tomorrow I'm getting the COVID meeting that we had. I mentioned I had a bike which I wanted to contribute, a lady's bike. And the more I think about Christine and the idea of wellbeing, I feel that, and also Claire had a wonderful idea about renting it out. It might be very useful if I get it out tomorrow, we take a photograph of it. It might be very useful as a sort of online you could make quite a lot of it, because there was a suggestion that it could be auction type thing. So it might be a good opportunity to sort of highlight this bike as part of the well-being, you know, opportunity when they're sort of
Sylvia, you know. Can I just pause for a little second to give everybody a little bit more information, because obviously the COVID meeting is a separate entity to this. So I think most of the people actually in the Zoom meeting were possibly involved in that, but there's probably quite a lot of the people who are watching this elsewhere who may not be. And also there'll be people who can watch this on catch-up later on. And the thing to point out is that basically Sylvia offered a spare bike that was in her shed to the community, and to essentially we were trying to figure out the best approach to deal with, what to do with it, etc. Whether that be to support Laurel Avenue and the work they're doing, or to support other organisations and the work they're doing, I don't think we actually got a complete idea of the conclusion to that plan, but that's the bank that Sylvia's referring to. Sorry, I just thought I'd give an update on what we're talking about there. Yeah. Sylvia.
I can't decide the best way to launch this bike, and I would like to give it to you, Christine, or Claire to decide the best way to get the best out of the donation, because it might go well with the launch of Wellbeing. It fits into Wellbeing. And anyway, we're getting it out tomorrow. And,
Okay.
And I'll send a photograph. I'll post a photograph.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that, Sylvia. Okay. Does anybody have anything else that they would like to comment? Okay. So I'm getting silence. I'll just keep an eye on the Facebook and the YouTube chat while I'm doing my wrapping up of the meeting, just in case anybody puts a contribution there. Can I firstly thank all of those people who've given up their time today to partake in this meeting, and those people who got in touch via email prior to the meeting for their comments, their continued support of the Residents Association. We currently don't have a plan as to whether we're going to do another virtual meeting yet, or when we're going to restart physical meetings, but that the latter, of course, depends on safety and the advice from the government. But you will obviously be informed as how what we're going to do by the email mailing list that most of you possibly got the invitation for this from, or from our Facebook group, which has all the information that we do and we publish out on there. Those posts are also being duplicated on the Gilesgate Coronavirus Updates group, which is the group that I run, which has about 700 people in the local community. So we do have a bigger audience than just the GRA being told about what we're doing and what we're getting up to. As I say, what the committee who are currently elected will do is to keep an eye on the keep our fingers to the ground, keep an eye on what's going on in the area. And should there be more things like the consultation, more planning applications, etc., that we think the community needs an input in, we will schedule another of these virtual meetings. And we're just trying to keep the GRA going up until the point where we can say that it is safe to hold a proper meeting. And at that point, you'll all get a leaflet through your door explaining when we're going to start and inviting every resident to the meeting. So that's the ongoing plan going forward. So that's it really from me. I'm looking on the social media. Chris Fletcher, message to Sylvia. If you want her to look at the bike, just send her a text message, okay? Thank you for me for hosting. Well, that's fine. I'm doing the best that I can. This is probably the first time I've done a meeting that's streamed onto four different platforms and used four screens. Can I also take the opportunity to thank Maria, who was volunteered by me to admin and has actually done a fantastic job passing the microphones around and everything. Finally, thank you to everybody for coming, and I look forward to seeing you soon. Stay safe and follow the advice of the government. Remember to wash your hands, and we'll get through this. And I'll see you on the other side. Thank you very much for joining, and goodbye. You find their meeting button, press it. There we are, got it.